Happy holidays to everyone. This is the second edition of Gaia's Voice. Messages from Gaia to be shared with you twice a month. I'm so happy to be able to do this with you. So happy to be able to touch your hearts, your homes, and to celebrate the holidays with you in this way. I'm very happy to be able to launch this at the end of the year, beginning of the new year. Something new, a new way for us to continue to connect with one another all over the world. So thank you for the opportunity to be with you in this way. And now let's see what Gaia has to say about our second topic, the holidays and Christmas. Indeed, I greet you once and always by whatever means is presented to us. If it is an ordinary day in which the sound waves will carry my voice, my energy, or that of the kingdoms into your awareness, then that will be our method for that day. And if on a day such as this, where electronic means present themselves to us as tools that we may employ to further our union, then that is what we shall celebrate. And so upon this day, where the very topic is the celebration itself, how is it that humanity determines what it will celebrate or whom it will celebrate? How is it that each culture determines for itself which of its celebrations will have longevity, which one history, providence, will carry into the future, and which will be left into history or time to consider? That is what we must evaluate as well. Now, perhaps it was said to you that we would here have either the true story or the true history of Christmas, although I must tell you here at the outset that it is almost impossible to do so. The reason being is that there is not one true, accurate history. Regardless of what subject you would choose, there is not one accurate or complete history. The fact is that humanity has a variety of timelines that it subscribes to. Imagine that in the same way that you subscribe to this edition or this story, there are a variety of other realities and dimensions, stories and historical perspectives that you subscribe to almost all of the time. For instance, how and where you work and how you collect yourself from that, what is considered leisure. All of this has changed throughout history. And so how or why you celebrate certain holidays, certain holy days, these perspectives have also changed. So we will consider history from a variety of perspectives, and from these you will be able to derive certain truths for yourself, why you hold them dear, which ones you may be willing to discard from choice, or, matter of fact, which ones may be imposed upon you. For it is time now that many of those things that you consider traditions and traditional, it is time for these to begin to move into other directions, and perhaps you have begun to see this in your life already. So, from a historic perception, we will begin even further than this holiday was, even further than what you would term the birth of the Christed One that inspired the holiday. Long and longer ago than you can imagine with your mind, and yet with your perception you will see that you will easily follow. There was a time in which humanity was fairly new to the earth still. New meaning that it had no true history. It had not truly the ability to claim the ownership of the earth. In fact, there were several at that time that could claim ownership at least to a piece of the earth. A time in which there were those that claimed this continent for themselves or this resource for themselves. And although you may look at the earth now and say, well, gold was the most precious resource and may still be, or water is the most precious resource. But at that time, because the earth was not well inhabited and still forming for itself quite a bit, there were many who came from more established worlds and more established planets. And they did not entirely claim ownership, but at least from a temporary perspective, they did seem to think that this or that belonged to them, if for no other reason that no one else was there to say otherwise, and no one else seemed to be interested in the resource that they were interested in. At that time, again, humanity was very new to the earth. And of course, we may leave it to a future topic, the debate of whether humanity was then created by those who came from other worlds, or whether those from other worlds inspired humanity to create itself and to evolve, or whether from all of the available genetic material and beings and kingdoms upon the earth, humanity formed itself. You see, even here, there are different timelines that would tell a different story. But for our purposes today, we will simply establish the fact that humanity, in a much earlier form, did already find itself upon the earth. It was not a well-organized humanity. There was not great leadership. As a matter of fact, humanity at that time looked for leaders or leadership to come from the stars. And, as has already been said to you, there are many different beings that did come from other worlds. And to this earlier version of humanity, it did indeed appear that all the great wonders or gods or all the great supernatural things came from the stars. There were particular times of the year in which the travelers would come to the earth. Now imagine this. For those that simply were here mining resources for themselves, it may simply have been a supply ship, for instance, that came to bring supplies or to exchange visitors or like that. But to the earlier version of humanity, these moments were momentous. They were very grand moments in which gods descended from the skies in order to bring great and wondrous happenings. And because they did seem to be on a somewhat regular basis, that early humankind began to view the stars in some ways as travelers or ships. And so the very planets were called then wanderers or travelers from a very, very long time ago, and the stars as well. To early humanity, when the very great beings came in their ships or manifesting upon the earth in the ways that they did, it was almost heart-stopping. And I will tell you that there were some that were so great and struck with fear at that time that literally their heart would stop. And so, when the great ones came from the skies, there are those who hid, there are those who feared, and of course, there are those that simply did not know what to make of it. And then there are those who became later the storytellers of your time, They became the ones that invented for others in order not to have fear. Why came these visitors from far away? What they bring or what they came to take by way of explaining to others so that there would be peace? These were not the true leaders of the time, but they were those that inspired others. They were inspired soothsayers, one could say, and that is exactly what they brought, a bit of soothing words to those that were in fear. When these beings came, they required the assistance of those who in some cases were willing to help, and in other cases it did not matter the willingness. They were put to the work or to the yoke, it could say. In these moments, then, those that came from other worlds brought with them certain incentives that were of interest to humanity. Some of these were related to foods that could be grown upon the earth, or certain other comforts that would be of benefit to humanity. It was not simply that humanity was given to the yoke or given to mandate certain work on behalf of other worlds. This is not entirely so. These are isolated instances, though of course they have gained acclaim with some of those that tell stories in your time now as well. During these moments, then, that which was brought from other worlds always was something new that humanity had not seen, had not heard of, something entirely new, something that changed their idea. Their ability to think was expanded. Their ideas and their communities were changed. And so these were great times of renewal for humanity. And when they began to come about on a solar basis, a yearly basis, then it did not take long before humanity could begin to mark this time. And so the very earliest instances we have then of this holy day, because it did come round near as possible to the winter solstice, these then were times in which rules were either tossed out or begun again, laws were changed, manifestations, magical things happened, new resources or new events were brought about. And so these were times of renewal. This then became one of the very first holidays, holy days, because in anticipation of these great happenings from the sky, well, you might imagine that it was difficult to simply work or go about life as if it were an ordinary day, when it was not an ordinary day or an ordinary time at all. And of course, sometimes we're seeing great and phenomenal events in the sky a few days or a few weeks even before the actual merging or manifestation upon the earth. So here I give to you a perception that you have no way to measure for yourself historical. It is not with historical accuracy that you could find yourself here, but more than likely your heart will say to you, yes. Your cellular memory will say to you, something here strikes a chord from longer ago, for even if it is not within my own memories, its possibility still ranks high within my thought processes. These moments, then, continued for quite a long time, with one race of beings or another manifesting themselves, and all the while humanity continuing to grow, to expand and to spread upon the earth. Well, as you might imagine, one group or one community might move from one particular location to another. When they did so, they took their stories, their histories, accurate as they may well be, to the next location. These were passed on to another generation, to another time. And that group then perhaps merged with another group who who may have been visited or merged or learned from a different visitor altogether. And of course, once all of the arguing was done as to who was historically accurate or complete, then more than likely these stories, these historical perspectives, were then merged one with the other and then passed on to the next generation. I will mention, as an aside, that your word tradition and traditional comes from an original word that meant passing along or passing on, or thou the past moves from the present into the now. It is a progression. And so the word tradition or traditional existed long and longer even before the written word could convey this. It was a thought, a very accurate one, of how something moved from one generation to the next, or how it moved from one area of geography to the next as well. Some of the historical perspectives, some of those that we could say this very much accurately happened at this time and place, no longer exists. And the reason for that is that timelines expire. Imagine that your subscription that you have given yourself may also at some time expire because it will not serve your current perspective or your current need or desire. In that same way, timelines do the very same thing. If all that is taking place within a certain timeline or generation or experience or existence no longer fits, no longer serves a greater purpose, it may as well literally run into a wall where it cannot go forward, not to the left, not to the right, and so it expires. There are certain early peoples of humankind that simply expired. They ceased to be. They did not have generations that went on ahead of them. They did not have profiles of peoples that merged with other peoples and became something else at a different time or place. They simply ceased to be. The stories no longer fit them. The bodies no longer served them well. The geographies in which they made their home did not support them, did not sustain them, did not feed them. And so, very great, in some cases, populations of peoples simply ceased to be. In these cases, their traditions, along with their history, along with all that they had brought forward to that timeline, ceased to be. And matters not how much someone would dig into an archaeological past, they would not find a truth to support the existence of certain peoples. However, those that did continue on, well, today you have a great deal of their perspectives. You have their histories contained within you. Most of these histories you travel with. They travel with you in your cellular thoughts, in your cellular memories, and these are passed on in written perspective, in oral, or simply in the way that you are. And all of this passing on, again, is what you consider tradition. But I wish for you to consider, at least for a moment, all of the timelines that are no longer so, all of the truths, all of the histories that have simply ceased to be. I will tell you that there is a part of each and every one of you that remembers or that feels in some way that something is missing, that some truth has been omitted from the past, that someone or something has not told you the complete and accurate history of your being. And that is correct. But I will tell you that it is not always necessarily because It is not willingly given, or because, as some will say, well, they cannot quite handle the truth yet, they must evolve beyond their current thoughts. No, in some cases, it simply ceased to be, and until its recurring thoughts are brought forward again, it will remain in that state. But I will tell you that in some way, these thoughts live within you still. For instance, today you have those that find themselves rather tied up in knots over the fact that one holiday is celebrated over another, over the fact that one religion, for instance, may be put above another or given more credit than others feel that it is due. And within you, there are the thoughts that something is missing, that something has been taken from someone, or that some aspect of their own truth is not being uplifted. And so to those that you see around you today that are up in arms over that Christmas, for instance, is celebrated above other holy or important days, or that it is given much more due in all perspectives, within these beings, there is something that aches just a little bit, something that aches for a timeline that is no longer, that they cannot remember, that they cannot represent, and yet that truth, that is what they lament. There is a sadness for that, but of course they do not understand that, they cannot remember that, and so instead it comes out a little bit like a jealousy, a little bit like an envy. If I cannot have mine, then you cannot have yours. If mine is not celebrated or given equal due, I will not celebrate or uphold yours. So for a moment, sweet ones, for just a moment, give each one upon the earth their due. Give one moment of remembrance or credit for the restoration of all of the truths, of all of the mysteries, of all of the perspectives, regardless of who holds them, or where they come from, or how they will make themselves known. Let us give one moment of light. Let us light a candle, if you like, in this moment, so that the light of all the world will be restored, and that one day you will have the same access that Gaia now has to all moments, even those that no longer are and cannot quite be brought forward again. Well, in returning to our subject then, of all of the moments, of all of the perspectives, we will say that the time of the winter came to be a very important time of renewal. It was a very important time because early humanity then did not have all of the abilities that you have now, either for shelter or for indoor heat or indoor plumbings or the ability to save food as you do now. And so the time of the winter, in essence, was a very dangerous time for humanity, and many perished. Many did not simply make it all year. Or, for those that had then dis-ease, as it would be, or illness, there was very little understanding of this. And because humanity was not given its divine credit at the time, it was simply thought that they were a very fragile race, particularly the early ones, susceptible to so many different diseases and entanglements with nature. And of course, you did not then have doctors, medicine, or technology to understand this. And so those that perished, well, they simply perished. And it was known that the winter was the greater season for this. For that reason, those of early humanity, well, they were particularly obedient during that time. Particularly, they would obey the rules as much as possible that were given to them, or those that they came to believe would in some way lead to longevity. And so they came to believe that what they could offer that they had, or what they could offer to one another that might keep their numbers safe and growing, this was the time of year in which they did so. And so now, to this holiday, to this holy day at this time of year, you have then the need to band together, if for no other reason than for warmth, the need to band together for supplies, the need to band together to share with one another what resources could be given. And so to this time of year now, you have not yet quite a celebration, but you have a coming together of communities. You have a coming together of different groups or tribes or those that simply live together in a family-like environment. And at this time of year, they would come together more often. At other times of year, they would go their own way and live in the ways that they did, perhaps completely different to each other. So now, at this winter solstice-like time, you have the looking to the stars to see who or what might come to resource or renew that time. You have the coming together of families and social structures, even from distances more than the ordinary, in order to come together for warmth and for sharing of resources. And of course, there were those that did not have as many resources as others, or the ability or the know-how of how to bring these together. And so there was always something that was saved for this time of year, something to save to exchange, something to save to learn from one another, something to give, and something that would bring others together. It was a time in which language was exchanged, for there were not all who knew how to speak. At this earlier stage, sign language, some form of symbols and signs, was appropriate. Some form of sharing and exchange came to be. Now, of course, we began by speaking during this time of all of those that may have come from the stars in order to resource their companions upon the earth. That lasted a relatively short period of time in your earth chronicle history. Eventually, those that came found other resources upon other worlds, other simpler ways to gather for themselves what was most needed, and truly, to be honest, they simply tired of humanity, which seemed to be rather rudimentary at that particular stage. And so, better put, they left the earth to humanity, which is entirely appropriate. When humanity then stopped receiving these resources, there was a time in which they did not know what to make of this. They continued to look for signs in the stars, or ships, or beings. And for a time, it seemed that almost anything that they came in contact with that was new, they gave something to, or gifted something to, whether it was from the animal kingdom, or a plant that they had not noticed before, or almost anything that seemed to fall from the sky, even if it was a meteoric rock. Well, even that was given a great deal of adulation at a time. But of course, the evolution of man began to speed and to evolve, until they stopped looking to the skies for all things. And yet, at this time of year, at the time of renewal, when they would gather, they would still, in some way, look to the stars for something, a remembrance, a sign, a symbol, a truth, a memory. And so your memories were born. Your memories come from the stars. Your earliest memories are that wonderful things come from the stars, that wonderful beings come from the stars, even if they were quite frightening, wonderful beings and things and ideas came from the stars and the greater heavens. And so always there has been a reverence on your part, and particularly at this time of year. Nonetheless, when the gods or the great beings ceased to come to the earth, traditions still continued. And so effects from the past were passed forward, and the traditions continued to evolve. As they continued to evolve, the time of renewal continued, and as there were more and more and more of humanity upon the earth, now there were also different cultures, and there were different customs, and all of these were expressed within different societal contexts. Well, for the sake of our time together, we may fast forward, if you like, to several different cultures that in their own way were the better storytellers, or the more accurate ones that could hold histories and relate to them. Even in the oral sense, they had the best ability to pass along to many members of their society what were the past stories, what were the past traditions, so that from these contexts then came a variety of different holidays, holy days. Much later were born the religious and the religion's ideas, and of course these then borrowed as well from the past. During this time, the pagan traditions and the religions lived side by side. At the time, there were many different religions, many different factions of many different religions, each one with their own idea, and most of these were not written down. You did not have your holy books then that were very specific, and of course you can see that even now your books are given to interpretation. It is a matter of who will interpret, so how the truth will come by, or how official the truth is given. And of course, those religions that have the greatest number of subscribers to them, well, these are given the greatest amount of truth. These are given the greatest amount of room to express their truth, simply because of the sheer numbers. Of course, their truths are not necessarily as provable through history than any others. But because they have had the ability for a longer time to put many of these truths in the written form and to have these translated to a variety of languages and to pass them freely throughout the world, this has given perhaps some of these truths more right to be, more right to exist, and more room to have called it historically truthful or historically accurate than others. But here, and for the purposes of our holiday, in our speaking, well, we give room to all. We give room to all of the beings to be, to believe, to create. And what better then than to say it is indeed the time of renewal in which heaven and earth come together, in which there are messages from the stars to renew, to bring truth, in which it is a time in which the pagans of long ago celebrated well the earth and the earth's ability to renew itself, all contracts to renew themselves, and for the earth itself to yield another year, to pass over from one year to the next, to give health enough that will give longevity, that will also pass with health into the next season. All of this was celebrated by the pagans, for rather than simply being days now of observing the skies, or days of observance, as they are still called, then they became days of renewal, renewing contracts with the earth, renewing a contract with one's own body, passing into the next year. And of course, those that banded together and were able to make it from one season to the next, enduring the long and harsh winters, these then did have cause to celebrate. These celebrations at first were in the spring, This was the time of renewal. Winter had passed, and all had then survived, or as many as possible had survived, into the next year and the next time of abundance. As an aside, I will tell you that your wreath, your holiday wreath, first began a little bit like a crown. Certainly you have seen these crowns worn by young maidens in the spring. They are made of sweet flowers, wild flowers, little herbs and such, celebrating the time of rejuvenation, celebrating whether it is the virgin that will give herself in order to continue to renew the earth. And during these pagan rites, then, all of the young maidens and such would make for themselves, or have made for them, these small wreaths as crowns to be worn about the head, a little bit like a halo of light or a halo of the earth. Well, long and longer ago these were saved. It was not simply a little crown to be tossed aside at the end of the celebration of spring. Oh, no, these crowns were held and cared for a great deal. They were kept as soft as possible, as new as possible. In fact, each one was to last an entire year. At the very least, it was that the better the maiden, or the better maid of these wreaths or crowns, were to last a year. At the time of the winter solstice, they were brought forward again, and these crowns then were embellished again with the fruits of labors or the offerings of the earth in the winter, those things that were hoped that would assist humanity in surviving the long winter and into the spring again. And so into the faded wild flowers and herbs were woven in then the berries of the winter, if at all possible, the soft nuts, or even the plants and seeds of those nuts that were harvested in the winter. And all of the winter, then, flocking was put about these to maintain, or to maintain the continuity of that crown, so that it would make it until the following spring, when a new one could be fashioned. For the most part, this was left to the younger ones to make, but of course there were those who were somewhat even in charge of guarding over the making of these wreaths and crowns. For although it may seem to you simply that which adorns a room now, they held very great symbolic importance at the time. Later, much later, because these were held and cared for so much, each household wished to share or to show others just how good a job they had done with their particular crown, and so here and there they were displayed. They were displayed or worn for certain celebrations, and then they were hung back in a place of honor, perhaps the hearth in the home, and then later as well into the opening to the hearth, or what today is represented by a door, or your front door, the threshold to the home, you see, for many homes today no longer have a hearth, simply the idea of that. And so a threshold will still serve in this way. And so you have here then your wreaths that are held over your door, and a bit of historical perspective for that, for you to make of what you will. We'll say to you as well that long and longer ago, what you think of as your Father Christmas, for instance, well, I will tell you that there was a Mother Christmas as well, for in these pagan days and pagan rites, it was the earth and the Mother Earth and the Gaian Earth that was celebrated as life-giving and life-sustaining. But because there were various differences between the genders, even as there is now, there was a different holiday or different celebrations, some for the man's and some for the woman's of the time. And so there was the equivalent of what you would call a father Christmas, a mother Christmas, or that which was the woman of the forest, the woman that knew the forest. And in order to qualify to be this great being, for it was a revered position indeed, it would be that those that claimed the honor were blindfolded and there sent into the forest. And there they were to then emerge at some point before the winter solstice, and they were to bring back from the forest all that was most needed, all that was most desirable in that particular community. They were not blindfolded all of the time. That was simply how they were sent forward. In other words, it was a symbol that said that in that moment they knew nothing. In that moment they were blind to the world and the world's gifts. But shortly after, and in some spirit of enlightenment, the earth kingdoms, the earth's magic would give, would return to that one their sight, or their second sight, their ability to see and to know what was most needed, and of course the ability to retrieve this. So those that were most revered then would bring back out of the forest perhaps medicinals, perhaps that which could later be made into certain tonics that would serve throughout the winter as well, those that would then warm the body, heal the body, those that could then be used for cooking, even spices, all that this mother of the forest would bring back, that was held in a very beautiful arrangement. And of course, those that remained in the smaller communities would decorate the hearth or make ready where a cellar, for instance, in which all of these needed gifts could be brought from the forest, and they would then guard next to these all through the night. Your idea now of the Christmas of guarding through the night to who will come or to leave even the food, if you like, for the one that will come. Well, long before your sweet stories now of the Santa that comes, there were those that were in charge of keeping some fire burning, because one did not know exactly when the woman of the forest or the man of the forest would return with all that they had brought. It was understood that what they would bring would then perhaps be heavy, or that they may become tired or burdened from their journey. And so it was given to one to keep watch over the night, or that the celebrations or preparations that they had made into the cellar where all would be put, that an animal did not steal in there during the night to disrupt all of this. So a guardianship or a vigil, an all-night vigil, was established so that by candlelight or firelight something would be maintained in the weights of the gifts that would be brought. So you see here I continue to offer to you perspectives, and you will see that in their own way they seem quite right to you. In some of these earlier times, then, the man of the forest would also return. The role was very similar to that of the woman of the forest, but it had its own differences, for at the time what the man would seek that was needed for a community might be different than what would occur to the woman. And so each was held in high regard, each was held equally. And during that time, I will say to you, if the pendulum were to swing more from one aspect to another, that it would indeed be more to the side of the woman. Later came the time in which the religions then took over a little bit more in charge of what the pagans had. They, those that managed the religions, had a better way to communicate to others. They had, in the most case, the way to write or to offer into the written language or into a variety of tongues. And so the pagan rituals went a little bit into the past, and the more religious ornamentation of the traditions came forward. The word ornament that you have, as in Christmas ornament, that came from this time of renewal of the pact with the religion taking over, taking the baton or taking charge. And so they took the smaller pagan rituals and ornamented them. They made them more ornate. They decorated them. They put decorum to them. They decorated the words and the actions. They gave official status to the dates. They gave rule and law and foundation to some of the ideas that were simple interpretations prior to that. And so then your holy days and holy times and ritual practices took on a different character again. Once again, traditions were passed on. And from here were born other ideas. You will see that more of the interpretations that they left or wove into the truths still benefited, for they wished to have great numbers come near them or to them or with them. So here I will tell you that even your trees that you celebrate, your Christmas trees that you celebrate now and bring into your home, these had begun as well as part of that pagan rite, and even before then as well. Imagine that the winters then being very cold long and longer ago, just as they are today, but of course the shelter not being as appropriate or as warmth-giving. So those that needed to hunt for at least the very simple meats, if possible, it was better if they did not have to go long and further away during the dangerous and cold time of the year. And so they would take certain sticky items, for that is how it was called, or traditional then, candied, sugared, honeyed items, and these were then ornamented onto certain trees, the trees that were the very closest to the village. And these then were then put, and truth being, they were more like little traps, if you might imagine, if you were to coat sweet honeys and sweet cakes upon trees to make ornament out of them. Well, certain little birds as well, and larger ones as well, that also were very hungry in the winter time and did not wish to go off very far. And so the birds then would come to the trees in order to feed for themselves for the long winter. And here, those that did not wish to go far and from the hunt, well, they would be nearby in order to capture these birds. So, at least in the cold winter, although one might not have as much meat as possible, at least they would have more birds at this time of year, more game birds in particular. And so now, later, you have the interpretation of trees that are decorated with pretty, sweet, alluring, colorful things in order to draw birds, and even today you have as ornaments birds, a variety of different birds, songbirds and sweet birds, and all of these to adorn your trees. And now I give you a bit of history associated with this. Now, where will you find some of this written? Well, it is difficult where you will find it, but you will see that little bits and pieces of these truths can be found. And now we come to how you celebrate your years and your holidays now. Still, I tell you, that it is the winter solstice that is marked within you. There is a part of you that recognizes this as part of the most important time cycle of the year. I will say to you that the winter solstice on your December 21st, 22nd, that is when you renew your contract with yourself. That is when you may look to the skies and then to the earth and say, yes, I am still here. I am still upon a journey of discovery. I have renewed myself at this time. I present myself even at the darkest and coldest time of the year, at the longest day of the year, even as my journey has been its longest and its most difficult. I present myself to both the stars in heaven as the messengers that they are, and to that of the earth where all is held quiet beneath the earth. I present myself to this time of mystery, and I receive it. I receive the light of the stars above. I receive its messages, be it those that I understand or those that come from longer away, or those that come in languages that I do not yet know, or from beings that I cannot remember. I present myself as one, one of a kind, one in oneness, one in unity, and I present such gifts to myself and to others as represent truth, renewal, coming together, or unity, restoration of purpose, discovery of the new or of the mysterious. I pledge myself to share that which I have gathered with others, to exchange with others the gift of knowledge, the gift of truth, to merge with others my own traditions, my own historical facts, accurate or inaccurate as they may be, my ability to inspire language to teach others, that my own timeline might be furthered or continued. I bring to this time my own ability to celebrate not only those truths that I have learned or accumulated, but those in which I may not be aware of yet, or those in which I may learn from others, be they other cultures, or traditions, or beliefs, or patterns, or religions, or spiritual traditions. I inspire within myself now both genders, that of mother and father, woman and man, as equal, beautiful, and important. And I dress myself in the symbols and traditions of the year, and I will call it what I feel inspired to call it. For true be told, I am one that has celebrated in this life and in others, more than likely, of every religion that has been, of every belief, from those that are the most holy, more than likely to those that have existed falsely until they dissolved themselves into the nothingness. So in this time of celebration and of renewal, I cultivate within myself the greater truths. And now that I have done this, now that we have done this, then, sweet ones, I will tell you that our bond of unity has been renewed. For I will always be present to celebrate with you, to inspire you, to draw from the past the allegories, the stories that will inspire your present. I will give to you all of the histories and the perspectives that you may fill yourself with, and perhaps especially those that will take you forward to create new ones. I did say to you in our beginning that there are new traditions that will come, for there are many that are being used or celebrated now, that the timeline will also come to a gentle conclusion. I will tell you that in less than a decade you will not celebrate this holiday as you do now. By then it will have a different meaning once again. It will have renewed itself, and that it will pass itself forward, inspiring the next generations to make of it something entirely different. And yet at the same time, you will still carry with you all of the traditions of the past, all of the memories within your cells, just as you do now. All of these will be carried forward and will inspire you to renew and to celebrate the earth, what it offers, and what you have to offer the earth. These changes, again, less than a decade, a very short time. In the meantime, by all means, celebrate. Celebrate. Not only the day, the time of the year, how you are inspired to share and to be with others. Let it be that which, again, is passed forward, that your past continues into the present and into the forward times, so that every day becomes a celebration of a greater truth, a more profound reason for you to be. Live within the reasonable, if you like, and the logical and linear, if you like. And now at the same time, let all that you have gathered into this basket of truth this day, let you fill that basket, and where possible, pass it along to others. Share with others those things that you value, that you treasure, that you would be willing to give to another, not because it has been purchased, simply because it has at least been thought, because it now has a will and a directive to be. And renew. Renew yourself, sweet one. Renew your contracts, your ideas, your thoughts, your abilities, your will. This, of course, then comes as well from what you would consider your renewals of the year and the time of the year. What have you made for yourself in terms of renewal? Have you made for yourself those ideas, those conjectures that you wish to carry from one year to the other? You call these resolutions now. What do you resolve for yourself? Well, see what you will gather into your basket. Let your resolution be that which you bring, that which you will take with you forward. For that which you decide to leave behind, that will take care of itself for the moment. I celebrate with you, sweet one. I celebrate with you. I raise a glass and toast to that which you are, to your longevity upon the earth, to your ability to evolve, to discover, and to celebrate one and all, the spirit of all that is, the spirit of this holy day, holy season, holy humanity, divine humanity. I bid you good day, offering to you as always my constant compassion and love. Until the next moment that we come together, I bid you good day.